probably hang out near the mic so the recording picks it up. You don't have to sit. Can it come up? Well, are you? Okay. So we're a tiny class today. This feels so weird to talk into a mic, but I'm going to do it because you're recording it for your classmates who are missing. So you guys know today is talk about capstone day. So I'm just going to turn it over to Beth because you're the boss.
You guys know Beth, right?
You do. It's good to see you guys again. Okay, so what we're going to cover tonight is that we're going to have all of the faculty members who are approved to be your capstone chairs. They're going to introduce themselves, kind of talk a little bit about themselves, what type of research they like to do. That includes both topics and then methodology. They're going to talk a little bit about what a capstone project is, which I know is probably on the top of all of your minds of what exactly is this thing. Because every year people go into it thinking it needs to be some sort of statistical analysis. It does not. It can take a lot of different forms, so we're going to cover those things. So both the what it is, then they're going to share some examples of what good questions students have asked in the past, because truly that's what all this is asking a good question that can be answered in enough time. That's right, you know, because I like to say it's like there's lifetime of work, there's dissertation, there's thesis, so they're going to help you narrow that down. We're also going to talk a little bit about what you should expect timeline-wise. There's going to be stuff that's going to be due both for your chair and for the class, and then for me that I need to get to the graduate school. And I've got a lovely handout with dates and all that stuff on it. But so we'll do that, and then Jenny is going to talk a little bit about the Policy Institute and the Center for Public Policy and Administration. And she's Dr. Robinson is willing to work with some students too, if you know what they're interested in matches up with what she does. And then finally we'll have, hopefully if he finds us, we'll have John Stillman, who's the director of Institutional Review Board. And so he's going to talk about when you need IRB approval and for what, and then, you know, if you're compared to, if you're just going to use it for in the class compared to if you want to publish and that kind of process, because for public policy students it's not always super cut and dry. So I think that's what we'll do, and then whoever faculty wants to come up first, you're it.
Hi, I'm Lena Svedin. I'm the acting director for the Masters of Public Policy program. Beth really runs it in reality, but I'm the figurehead for the moment. But I've worked with the MPP program for a long time, and I love it. I think it's an awesome program. I am one of the core faculty members who can help you figure out what you want to do for your capstone project. And I teach public policy, not only in the MPP program, but in the Masters of Public Administration program. So I have a lot of background in doing policy analysis, that is trying to figure out, well, let me backtrack before we get too much into that, because I get all excited and then we could get really sidetracked. What is a capstone? Let me give you my 25 cents on how you could think about a capstone, right? If you were in a different kind of program, if you were working to become a carpenter, making fine furniture, then towards the end, you would probably need to do something to prove your skills. So something like an armchair, or if you were in a sculpting program, you would have to have a show showing off your sculpting pieces. And so the capstone is really that kind of a piece. It's genuinely yours. It's something that you have decided on and designed, and something that you've done, a research paper that you have done together with some help from a faculty member, where you draw on many of the things that you have learned in the program. You can take and borrow from different classes, different methods or ideas, or an interest in an issue that you got from one class, and you design your own project. And this is sort of your, you know, this is your headpiece. This is what I've done. Look, this is what I can do now towards the end of my program. But it's also a fantastic opportunity to really dig into a topic that you haven't had time to explore as much as you would have liked in your program. I like protracted social problems like homelessness and domestic violence and, you know, poverty, things like that. That's my cup of tea. Those are some of my favorite things. And when we study policy analysis and learn how to do policy analysis, I have my students learn skills of how to actually frame a problem and then analyze it, generate options, pick values to assess those options, which outcome of an option that I hope is going to happen would be the best one. So I have a lot of students learning those kinds of tools and drawing on theory about why people are poor or what goes into homelessness, you know, what these populations are facing on a daily basis that make them stay homeless, for instance, or what helps, what makes a difference in changing that condition and getting them out of homelessness permanently or at least for longer periods of time. So if you are interested in social issues, if you think like, why do people do this? Why is it we have such wacky policy around something? Or there seem to be so many people on the streets lately. Why is that? You know, if you are puzzled by any of these things, you know, why a certain population is behaving a certain way or how policy is influencing their choices and what's available to them and maybe what other states have done outside of Utah, maybe, I don't know, Oregon or looking at Florida or other states and go, how do they work with homelessness or how do they work with welfare? If you're interested in that kind of thing, then I'm a good person to come to because I'm good at brainstorming how you could compare these things and how to kind of frame your puzzle, what makes you go, huh, you know, or keeps you interested in a topic and get it down to about one sentence after some chiseling. It takes a while. But once you know what you're going to look at, that pretty much tells you what method you need to use in order to shed light on that problem or to answer that question if you have an actual research question. Sometimes you just have a research puzzle because you don't even know exactly what the key question is. But you have a puzzle. It's like, why is this the case? Or why, you know, this seems to be the case. Is that really what's happening? And is it worse now than it was before? Or is it better now than it was before? And why is that? So that's the kind of thing I do. I'm schooled in quantitative methods, but we have two faculty members, Lori and I just had a brain fart. Sorry. Kathleen, thank you. They are really good at quant. I'm decent at quant. I don't get to teach it, but I can hack my way through it if necessary. But what I am really good at is case study analysis. So if you want to write up a story or a situation that has to do with public policy, I'm a really good person to go to because I know a lot of methods around case study analysis and comparative case studies, comparing policies, and how to look at policy text and compare sort of the rationales in them and how people are motivated, what they're doing, and sort of the values that go into policy. So if you're interested in any of that stuff, then I'm a really good person to come to. And also, if you have a really wacky topic that nobody else wants to work on, I'm totally your huckleberry. I like to span a wide gamut. So if you have a topic that you don't think fits perfectly with anybody else, then I'm more than happy to listen to you and try to figure out how you could do what you want to do, right? And get it done on time. I'm also really good at that. Cutting it down to a size that's manageable, that you will actually get done in the time allotted. Because we don't want to hold you up from graduation just because you have vaulting ambition. That's why you're here. You have vaulting ambition. You came here. You're going to change the world. But let's make sure you graduate so that you can get that good job and change the world. So is there something else I should talk about? I'm losing my voice, as you can tell. But hopefully by the time you come around to see me, I'll be fit as a fiddle and happy to talk to you about any of the research that I've done previously. Oh, I should tell you about some of the projects that students that I've been advising have done. One student looked at drug testing welfare recipients. It was a policy option a couple of years back in Utah. They wanted to start drug testing people, so if they were on drugs, they wouldn't get welfare money. And she had this idea that maybe that wasn't a super effective way of going about it. So she compared how other states that have tried this, what their results were, and made a forward projection for Utah of whether or not this would make sense, whether or not it would be effective. And they've also looked at things like, are environmental nonprofits effective? Judging from the characteristics in the literature, in the theory, about what makes a nonprofit effective, if they have those things, are they also more impactful than if they don't have those things. What else have we looked at? Oh, vaccines. Basically saying this is a very effective medicinal remedy, but why is it so controversial? Why is it so rife with conflict? And she did a historical analysis of policies and politics around vaccines. It turned out to be a fabulous study. It was almost 80 pages long, not what I would recommend, but it was a fabulous study. She just couldn't stop writing because she thought it was so fascinating. I've had all kinds of fun projects. I hope that you get some good ideas from this, and you're welcome to come back and talk to me anytime. Yeah.
Do you want to go over for a minute what your own research background is?
Sure. I've done crisis and disaster research for a really long time. So how organizations and decision makers do, how well they perform in crisis situations, and what tends to make crises worse or better handled. Then I kind of shifted into accountability and ethics. So I've done a lot of ethics in crisis management, ethics in risk management, accountability and public trust in governing institutions. So I'm mostly doing policy in a particular situation, which is crises or disasters, and then also add the ethics component or the accountability component. I wrote a quantitative dissertation, but since then I've done mostly qualitative work. I've been working on this for about 15 years. Yeah.
You said that you'd be interested in domestic violence.
Yeah.
Would you be interested in family policies, like parenting practices and stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. We also have our friends from Family and Consumer Studies. They may also have an interest in this, but I'm definitely interested in the research I'm doing right now is I'm doing a book project on taboos, how we make policy about things we feel we can't talk about, like homelessness, economic inequality, incest, and suicide. So, yeah, all the misery of the world, that's me. I like to look at that stuff. Thanks.
I always feel like things get so serious when you stand in front of a microphone, right? And this is such a small group, I feel like we should just be sitting around a dinner table and having a conversation instead. But thanks for letting me go. My little girl Stella's in the back room, and I hope she's in the back room still. you can see her? Okay. And she probably is looking forward to getting home, but I'm entertaining her on the phone for a minute, and she's playing games. Beth asked me to come and visit with you, and I thought I'd spend a minute talking about my own interests, and then we could talk a little bit about where I work, because maybe I'm not the perfect fit for your interests, but I can match you up with people in our office who do some really great and incredible work that has an impact in our state and in our community. So my name's Jenny Robinson, and I am a political scientist. I have a PhD here from the University of Utah, and my favorite thing is political behavior. That's what I study. I did a dissertation that was a mixed methods, qualitative and quantitative, on voting rights for American Indians. And I looked at three cases across the West where we had legal changes and it impacted the behavior of American Indians living in these three counties. So that's my real interest. I've done some other work outside of my professional life on human trafficking and studying tuition for undocumented immigrants too. So if you have interest in those areas, let me know, and I'd be glad to work on those too. Professionally, I direct the Center for Public Policy and Administration, which is here on campus, and we have nice ties to the Master in Public Policy program and the Master in Public Administration program both. Our office has been around for, I think, 68 years and has made a huge impact in the community. We act really like a consulting firm, and we contract with state agencies, cities, counties, nonprofits, and a little bit in the business community, and do a ton of work on a vast array of topics. We work with the health department, we work with workforce services, human services, cities and counties, and I'll tell you, there's probably not a topic in this room that we haven't touched in some way over our 68-year history. I just invite you to go to the website cppa.utah.edu, and under at the top there's a link that says portfolio. You can click on that, and by topic area you can see hundreds of articles and things that we have, reports that we have done, and if there's something that matches up and links with your own interests, come and visit with me, and I'd be glad to support you in your research over the next year and a half. And I'm also happy to make connections in the community. For example, let's say you wanted to do something on immunization. I'm happy to make those connections in the health department so you can get data or do interviews with somebody. Glad to do that. Maybe it's interest in water policy. Glad to connect you with environmental people in the governor's office or in nonprofits. So just keep me in mind as you're going along. I'm here to be a resource and help you in any way. This program's really important to me and near and dear to my heart. So I want you all to be very successful. Okay? Okay.
I know, I sort of wish Natalie Gochner was here. She'd really get that, because that is what her husband does. Yeah. My name's Morgan, to the students in the room. So I actually never realized mine and Jenny's interests, research interests, aligned so much. You can keep leaving. Keep walking. Bye. I also do voting behavior, political behavior, so if you're looking to see why legislators or members of Congress behave in certain ways, if you're looking at why people vote certain ways, whether or not they vote, why or why not are they voting, those sorts of things. While I was at Utah Foundation, it actually is really similar to CPPA. I actually didn't realize they were about the same age, too. It sounds like they were both formed shortly after World War II. There I was required to be a jack of all trades, and so I did everything from education to the economy to taxation to all those things. It was all very state focused. Sometimes we would do 50 state surveys, stuff like that, but if you're looking more local or just as Lena was saying as well, you want to compare to other states, I can do that as well. What else? Oh, my dissertation, as I've told you guys, was about Congress and foreign aid. So I sort of tied the international with voting, or not voting behavior, congressional decision making. So that, I thought that was fun. So if you think that's fun, come talk to me. As for methods, my dissertation was also a mix of quantitative and qualitative. I know I taught your guys' quantitative class, but what I've actually implemented a lot is more qualitative stuff and low-level quantitative. I'm happy to help assist you with some of the higher level, but these two really are the experts on that. And, oh, examples of, do you guys like how we're just like handing all the math to you? Math. So good, this is actually just my first year advising students. But one cool project a student is doing this time around is he's looking at policies regarding migrant workers. And the timeline for how long people can use visas is usually a year or 2 years. But if the job gets really hard, for instance, sheep herding, which is a really hard job because you're in the mountains camping, and it's cold and it's snowy and it's difficult. Those are, if I remember right, 3-year visas. So he's looking, trying to look at if that makes a difference, if that's helping bring people into those jobs, and why other types of jobs that might be really difficult aren't being given that same treatment. So that's different. And then just people I've worked with in the past that I know came through this program that I thought had interesting capstones. One student was looking at whether cities that have economic incentives for companies, whether or not they weathered the Great Recession better than other cities. I thought that was an interesting one. And then one student, I think she graduated 2 years ago, was looking, she did a historical look, I think it was historical, Sarah Ward was hers, historical look at immigration, and seeing as national policies change, did that influence whether illegal immigration went up or down? So I thought that was an interesting one as well. Questions? Okay, I'll sit again.
So I'm Kathleen Zick, and I am an economist by training, but very much an applied economist. My interests in terms of my own research have been very eclectic over the years. Maybe it's we self-select into public policy if we've got eclectic interests, I don't know. But I have done studies that are as far-ranging as looking at, that are have public policy relevance, looking at as genetic testing has expanded in the United States, should we have laws that protect genetic privacy, or should insurance companies have access to that information so that they could properly price insurance policies if someone tests positive, say, for an adult onset disease that might shorten their lives or increase their health care costs? In that area, I've worked with colleagues in the health sciences on the genetic tests for BRCA1, which is associated with the risk of breast cancer, 85% lifetime risk, and also APOE4, which is associated with Alzheimer's disease. And so we looked at what it meant for insurance purchasing behavior and how you balance that off against privacy rights for individuals who've undergone testing. And it's still sort of a open question in some respects, although we have, as a society, we have moved on the side of erring towards protecting privacy, which I think is a really good thing. So that's one area where I've done some evaluation research. I've also worked with my colleague Rob Mayer, who is not part of the core faculty in the public policy program, but does a lot of public policy related research on consumer issues. So if you were interested in consumer policy, he would be someone I would really encourage you to seek out. But Rob and I have looked and done evaluation studies of the effectiveness of the Consumer Product Safety Commission and mandatory seatbelt laws. As you can see, this is very eclectic. So I covered a wide range of topics over 30 plus years. Within the context of the public policy master's program, I have historically taught the program and policy evaluation class. If you guys are planning to take that next fall, you will not be taking it from me. And if you know someone who is in the program this year, they didn't take it from me either, unless you were talking to Stefan Rodewalt, who's actually a third-year student. I did not teach it this year, and I won't be teaching it next fall because of some administrative duties that I've taken on, but I will be teaching it next spring. So if you wanted to wait until your last semester, that's shaking your head no, or if you're do it on the three-year plan because you're working full-time and you're going part-time, then you might you will have choice next year as to whether you take the program and policy evaluation class in the fall or in the spring. Jerry Benson will be the instructor in the fall, yeah. So I may not see any of you, but if you are interested in doing evaluation-related research, that is, if you're interested in trying to understand whether an existing program or policy is effective in terms of accomplishing its goals, and or efficient, if it does it in a cost-effective manner, then I would love to have a conversation with you because those are the types of studies that I really enjoy getting involved with. I have supervised qualitative studies. In fact, I was just thinking back to yesterday. This is why it's really important.
To yesterday.
Well, no, I was thinking back because yesterday, 2 days ago, I gave a reference for a 2011 graduate of our program who is just moved jobs. She just was offered a position as an analyst with CLASP, which stands for, is it the committee? Center for Law and Social Policy. Couldn't get this. So this is Nune Phillips. So anyway, she's moving to D.C. to take that position from Ann Arbor, where she'd been working with a consulting firm there. So, and I was still doing references for her because she was my student. So, you know, who you choose to work with also is a pathway to jobs, as even though I didn't know the name of the organization, I still gave her a strong recommendation, and she got the offer. This is not a decision to be made lightly. I would also encourage you to talk to current second year students to find out what their experiences have been working with their capstone supervisors, because they can tell you, oh, you know, that Zick, don't work with her, man. She makes you meet with you every week, and we have to, you know, she sets deadlines for me. And if that's not your style, then, you know, that's good advice to get. Talking to the second year students, I think you will get sort of the, you know, the unadulterated version of how it is to work with each one of us. And so I encourage you to do that. In terms of the range of students that I have worked with, most of them have done something that's quantitative. But in Nune's case, actually, she, the alum who's going to DC, she did a policy analysis where she was comparing TANF policies in Utah to TANF policies in Idaho. It was totally qualitative. She did a fabulous job. She did that because in part she was working for Workforce Services at the time, and so she was doing intake for TANF, and so she really wanted to understand the differences between what was going on in Utah and Idaho, because the programs were structured somewhat differently across the two states. But most of the projects that I've supervised have been quantitative. Not all of them have been evaluations. Some of them have been needs assessments or interesting public policy research questions that someone wanted to answer but didn't necessarily have implications for assessing whether a policy was effective or efficient. I have recently had a couple of students who have gone on to work with me to have their capstone projects published in peer-reviewed journals. So Emily Mader, who finished up 2 years ago, almost in May, she and I have a piece that was just published this past year. In her capstone project, she was looking to see whether state laws, traffic safety laws, impacted not motorists, but pedestrian non-motorist fatalities, which is actually an understudied area. And she was very interested in cell phones. So she started out wanting to look at cell phone laws. And we did a fixed effects analysis where we incorporated not only cell phone laws, but what were the state's laws with respect to blood alcohol content and with respect to speed limits and lots of other things, to see whether it had an impact on pedestrian fatality rates. And it turns out that the most important thing, if you want to minimize your risk of dying in an automobile-related accident where you aren't in a car, is to be in a state with really strict blood alcohol level laws. You're much less likely to end up dying. So that's the other things didn't seem to matter, but that really did. And then Seth Teague and I worked, and this is, again, shows how eclectic the work is, but he was very interested in air quality issues. He graduated last spring, and he did an evaluation of the Clear the Air Challenge. How many of you have heard about the Clear the Air Challenge? Every summer, right? You know, Governor Herbert gets out there and says, you know, get online, sign up, pledge that you're not going to drive as much, tell us how much less you're going to drive, and you know, you're going to be entered for prizes, and there can be team competitions, and it's always during the month of July. Earlier, it varied actually across time span in the summer. So he, in his capstone, did an initial analysis, and then we pushed it further last summer after he graduated and looked to see whether the Clear the Air Challenge as a type of soft transportation policy was having any impact on air quality and summertime ground level ozone levels in the Salt Lake Valley. So we had data from the Hawthorne School, which is where they collect the data on ozone and particulate matter each day. And we had data on fires, so wildfires, and we were able to control for the days that the 4th of July and the 24th, when we also do things that add to poor air quality, and look at the impact of when the Clear the Air Challenge was in place and whether it made a difference in terms of both ozone levels and then red, yellow, and green days. And it turns out that it is not effective. So that has just been conditionally accepted in a journal as well. And so I really like working with students on a whole range of projects, I guess, as I should sum up. But I have to say that I really love working with students who want to take their projects even further to peer-reviewed publication. So if that's something that you have on your to-do list over the course of your life, you know, I'd be happy to talk with you about possibilities. And obviously, I'm open to a wide range of topics. I never thought I'd be doing anything on ozone or, you know, pedestrian traffic-related fatalities. So anyway, any questions or... In terms of topics?
Yeah.
So I, this is something else I guess I should have mentioned. I have worked, I mean, like Seth Teague came to me and said, I want to do something on air quality. And we just brainstormed until, like, you know, what would be a good policy relevant question where we could get quantitative data. And, you know, that worked out well. I've had other students like Nune who came to me and said, I know exactly what I want to do. Here's my topic. And then I've had students who've come to me and said, I don't have a clue what I want to do. And in fact, Anna Bergevin, who works at CPPA, I worked with her last year. She did a cost-benefit analysis that was part of a larger project that I'm involved with, looking at the passage of mandatory CMV testing here in the state. And so I just sort of, Anna came to me and she said, well, I'm not sure what I want to do my project on. I said, I've got this great, you know, idea here. I thought it was great. You know, it's a really interesting topic. We had the legislature passed this law to CMV is, now I'm going to forget what that says. Anyway, it is a virus that if you get it while you're pregnant and you transmit it to your baby, they've got a 20% chance of having profound hearing loss at birth. And there are interventions to minimize the hearing loss, but they have to happen within the first few weeks of life. And so Utah is the first state to pass a law that mandates that infants that fail their newborn hearing screening twice have to undergo CMV testing and hopefully then enter treatment for it. So this, Anna didn't know anything about this. I hardly knew anything about it. I was working with a pediatrician on a larger project, and he said, you know, we really, it would be great if we could get an analysis of whether this law is cost effective. And so that's what she did her project on. So if you don't have, I think it's fine at this stage to not know what you want to do your capstone on. And what I would encourage you to do is to set up some appointments with, you know, Jenny or Lena or Lori or myself or Morgan and sort of shop around. I mean, I'm an economist, so I believe information is good and you should have full information before you make decisions. So invest some time talking with people and see what sort of strikes your fancy, because the truth is, with a capstone or with a dissertation, whatever the big project is, there's going to be some night where you're going to be up, it's going to be 2 a.m, you know that you've got to get that paper finished or that section finished because you've got to get it to your committee chair the next day. And if you aren't passionate about what you're doing, you're going to say, you know, I'll just go to bed now. So it really helps a lot, I think, to get over the finish line if you really care about the question that you're doing research on. So shop around and, you know, figure out what really resonates with you is my advice.
You, tough act. So I'm Laura Kowalski-Jones, and I am a core faculty member, and so you will see me, probably. Well, you're going to see me at some point, because you need to take survey research methods, and that's the class that I teach. And I'll be teaching it this fall, and I teach it, well, I kind of looked at what Kathleen did. I'm like, I'm going to do what she does, because she does really a great job. And so in my class, like in Kathleen's, we do applied research. And insofar as in my class, you will be in a group, you will partner up with a community agency or a government kind of entity and do a survey beginning, middle, and end. And so that's a good way to kind of get to know me in the fall, because I think that there is a piece that's going to be happening in the fall. So you'll see me in the fall. My background is that I'm a sociologist, But then I am, and in kind of my kind of training there, was very interested in the built environment and how it related to youth behaviors. But then had a postdoc at Northwestern where I was at a policy center and really became very interested in kind of, I've always was interested in policy, but that was kind of the place where I'm like, oh, this is where it all makes sense for me. And in that context, did research on kind of family structure transitions and the implications for behaviors. And then also food programs. I did evaluations in some ways. My brand of program evaluation is you have an interest in a certain program and you want to know the effects on individual behavior. For example, I had some money from the USDA to look at the effects of the WIC program on infant birth weight and used different statistical techniques to kind of separate out selection, non-random selection into the program and then the effects on birth weight. And then actually that ended up being a capstone years later for a student who was interested in, you know, kind of health and food and public programs. And so Chad Midgley worked using the same data and then actually used the same structure to look at the effects of WIC, prenatal WIC participation on maternal weight gain. And, you know, does participation in the program contribute after you kind of control for non-random selection in WIC to, you know, lesser weight gain or optimal weight gain? So I like questions like those. I've studied the school lunch program and the effects on you know, academic outcomes, behavioral outcomes. You know, and I've worked with, I've started working with MPP students in 2010. That's when I first started teaching the class. And so I've done a lot of different interesting projects with students. You know, again, this eclectic piece. But people generally come to me if they want to do a quantitative data project. I've done a variety of things, though. I had a student, Marcy, who did a needs assessment for the Democratic Party. And so I, you know, kind of, what's that? They do. Well, that was, you know, maybe one of the, that was among the recommendations she made. So, and then I've had other students, for example, I'm working with Tory Lyons right now, and he is interested in environmental policy, and so he's linking gas prices to UTA ridership. And that's been just a ton of fun to work with him on that. I've had other students that kind of fall into my area of, if you're all about the food, you're going to come to me. I worked with Claire Tobin-Lentz this last year. She was really interested in the impact. What are the influences between education and income, and how do these things interact to affect healthy food-seeking behaviors? And so she wanted to do a quantitative analysis, and so she ended up doing this mediation analysis, and I directed her to, like, okay, well, we have to think about what data you can use, well, how can we find some good data, and she ended up using the National Health Examination Study data, which I use on another project, and kind of, you know, played around with these relationships. And I think that when it comes to capstone students, you know, you kind of, sometimes, you know, I think, Elena, you're talking about, you know, that beautiful armchair. I've had students that are like, I want to do a dinner set. Like, you know, you can't do the dinner set. Maybe a great chair. And I've had students who have come to me like, no, you know, I've got this passion. I'm really interested in foster care issues. And I want to go to the State Board of Education. And then I want to take this data. And then I want to get here. And I want to do this. And, you know, kind of backing students up like, okay, well, you know, I don't know if you're going to get this data in time. Yeah, as a matter of fact, you're right. And then this particular student, Jamie, she ended up using some existing data and looked at risk factors for high-risk students. And it ended up being a really great thing that translated, and she ended up going to the University of Chicago for a bit. And they really liked this, you know. And so it's interesting the kind of trajectory that students take of what I think I want to do to what I end up doing and how that ends up, you know, kind of gifting me later on. And I think Kathleen's right. You know, writing a reference letter for Nune, I just had lunch with Matt Conway last week because he's got a new job at the Department of Health and he's freaking out, you know, how do I do this? And I'm like, you can do this. And so, you know, we had lunch, we talked about it on plan, you know, and I think that these relationships really, one of the great things about the MPP program is that people are kind of placed all over the city and then more broadly as well, but yet, you know, you can kind of stay in touch and you can kind of have this community and it feeds on each other. And I have had, you know, I feel like, you know, that old commercial for Hair Club for Men, I'm not only a customer,
customer. I'm, you know, I'm the president. I've had so many students that have been my student, not so many, but enough that it's remarkable, that have been in my class, they're placed in a community organization, they come back to me afterwards and they say, I got a project for you. You should, you know, have students, you know, I've had at least three. I've done a project with the Chamber of Commerce, Mike Merrill. I've done multiple projects at Voices for Utah Children when Barb Munoz was working there. So it's a great community that is really kind of supportive, and it's a lot of fun. So if you've got interest in food and kids, I now study a lot of different kinds of related papers on the built environment, the relationship to energy balance issues, kind of weight and physical activity, and thinking about kind of that non-random selection piece. So that's kind of where my head's at now, but it can be a lot of different places. You know what? I can actually. When I first started teaching, a student asked me, "Do you come from a family of auctioneers?" And I said, "Why, no, but you know, maybe that'll be my plan B if I don't get tenure." But I got tenure, so here I am. So, any questions? Okay.
Okay, so you've got a lot of good information. We met all the capstone advisors, so you've kind of got a concept of that. And so I want to cover, when you leave here, what's your assignment? And it's truly to start thinking about who I want to work with. So I like the idea of kind of shopping around. And then what broad topic could I sit with for a year? Doesn't have to be your question. You know, it's like, for me, it's like, I'm particularly interested in LGBT issues. Great. So then Kathleen would say, like, well, what about that do you want to study? And then we'd start talking. It's like, I'm interested in, you know, and the protection policies, and if that's going to help us recruit and keep people. Great. And she'd say, where are you going to get your data from? You know, so it's like, what you need to know going into fall is what's going to be interesting to you for the long run, and then who you think you're going to want to work with. And so if you guys were super Johnny on the spot and researched the capstone projects and the process before this point, or before you even started the program, in the beginning it used to be 1 4-credit capstone class in the spring, and we decided to break that up because you were doing a lot of work in the fall without getting any actual credit for it. And so I don't know if you've looked at your sheet of what kind of stuff you're going to be doing with your advisor and that 1 credit graded independent study in the fall. Which will be a nice lead-in for John, who is the director of IRB, and you need to know who he is, because he will potentially be your best friend or your worst enemy. No, I don't know that that's true. But so what I need from you guys is for this semester, start thinking about who you want to work with, and let me know April 24th. And we just want to make sure you get registered with who you need to be registered with. Start working with them in the fall. Don't ignore my emails. The grad school needs paperwork from you guys, so I will be sending out your who your full committee is, and at that point you'll have decided with your capstone of who could be a nice person to help you with your content area or your methodology. We'll have to have you register for graduation November 1st, program of study December 15th. So as long as you check your email, you're in good shape as far as that. And last thing I want to say is why we decided to separate these two things was truly, we took feedback from the last 6 graduating classes of when people got in trouble and didn't get to graduate on time, why was that? And it was because they went too far in the spring without having finalized their question or having their data set. And so the further we back this up, the better. We also wanted to give the chairs, basically, we want you to be accountable to your chairs because they are the one human being who decides if you graduate. So we wanted to make sure that you're keeping them happy too. And so we have a list on the back of what I handed you of what you're going to be working on in the fall, which is what you had been doing anyway, but now you get a grade for it, which is nice. And that's going to be understanding human subjects, human research subjects, working with IRB, doing their training modules, formulate your research question, put together a lit review, which I think you'll do a little bit from Morgan's class potentially, and then basically figure out your data set. If you go into spring with a data set, you're going to be in great shape. And then that also frees up some time for us to do cool stuff in the class, like marketing policy for different audiences, different education levels, different, you know, they're not going to read your research paper. You've got 30 seconds go, you know, which is kind of the way we work with legislators. And just being able to sell it, and then including the ethics of public policy, because we weren't covering that before, and that's something we should definitely do. Okay, so I'm going to turn it over to John Stillman. He's the director of the Institutional Review Board, and he's going to talk about when you need to get full approval, when some things are already covered, and you just, you know. And the nice thing is, listen to him, because your chairs are vouching for you. If you really screw this up, it could be the end of your chair's career. I don't know that that's true, but...
Hi, thank you all for having me tonight for the seminar. I think for groups like this, I generally try to be really informal, and in fact would be happy to answer questions about your specific projects rather than just kind of talk to you about the IRB if you're only going to really have to deal with us, you know, a tiny bit or touching us for part of your master's project. But anyway, I can start by telling you kind of some of the definitions of research and how we function, and maybe that might even spur some questions about your project. In the many cases, actually, the way that I would start here is to talk about the definition of human subjects research. So the Institutional Review Board is tasked with overseeing all of the human subjects research that's conducted at the University of Utah under our Human Research Protection Program. We're a very, very large program, especially for the West, the Mountain West, and certainly the largest in the region. I think that's partly because of, on the biomed side, we're the only academic medical center in the area. But today we oversee about 6,000 active projects, including what we call exempt projects, which typically mean that we review them initially, but you never really have to come back to us again. So we're a very big program. You basically, heading west, have to hit some of the larger UC schools to see a similar research portfolio. And heading east, you start to see programs like ours maybe in Chicago and then definitely on the East Coast. But you're part of a very large and complex human research protection program here in the Mountain West. So our breakdown in the IRB in terms of human subjects research today approximately is about 75% biomedical research and about 25% social behavioral, or we often just say main campus research, to throw the term in there like that. And the way that our boards are structured to review research is we basically request faculty members from given departments based on the volume of research that we receive. So obviously we can never get a perfect, you know, sort of discipline-to-discipline match, but we can often match expertise pretty closely based on the research that we review. So we hope, anyway, that when we look at your projects, they're being assigned to faculty members who are familiar with the kind of work that you do and are able to be useful contributors for you. Probably one of the most important things I can tell you as students is that your faculty advisor is really crucial in dealing with the IRB. So if you're not a faculty member and you submit through us, you have to have what we call a faculty sponsor. You can be the principal investigator, the investigator, the head of your project. But when you hit submit in our electronic system, the project will go first to a faculty sponsor who has to sign off and then send the project through. And I can tell you, I don't know because I don't actually do reviews on the board, but our board members say that you can very clearly tell when a faculty sponsor is involved with a student and helpful and reviewed their project versus when they have it. And we have to go back and maybe sometimes help make sure that everything is compliant with our world in the IRB. But you guys are going to be an interesting group because when I talk about the definitions of research, well, I'll just tell you, and we can discuss the issue yourselves. There's two definitions that we apply for any project that hits our door. And if it doesn't meet both of those definitions, we'll tell you that we shouldn't be involved in the review. And the first is, does it meet the regulatory definition of research? You know, this is certainly no kind of a value judgment based on what people consider to be research. This is just from the letter of the law what we have to review. And the regulations intentionally cast a wide net. So in other words, I think they want to drive faculty and students to the IRB to ask us whether or not we need to oversee the research or we need to review and approve an application. So the definition of research from the regulations is a systematic investigation designed to contribute to generalizable knowledge. And I think obviously anything you guys do or most people do in an academic setting and for research is hopefully systematic and generalizable. But the regs give us a little bit of guidance in terms of generalizing, and that says that often generalization can be considered an effort to publish or present outside of one's institution. So I think that's very interesting when I heard Dr. Zick discussing some students who had worked with her and actually published in peer-reviewed journals. One tipping point for research that you do could really be whether or not there is an opportunity to generalize it. And unfortunately, I think this is a flaw in the regulations, we can't grant it retrospectively. And that's too bad because I think that, you know, in many, many cases we see for master's projects, they're not ever published or disseminated significantly outside of the institution. So we could technically say, hey, we don't even need to see that, even if you are working very clearly with human subjects. The problem is if you think there may be an opportunity to publish, you need to get that approval before you get started, so that if you do want to publish in the journals, and now you guys can probably speak to this, more and more of them will actually ask you to produce something that says whether or not you've asked the IRB about the project. That could be a big determining factor. So I think that's really challenging whenever I talk to classes, like at the master's level, for example. It's hard to know whether or not your project will be something that would meet the regulatory sort of idea of generalizing, because if we say it won't be generalized, you're already basically don't require IRB review or oversight. But again, that can be challenging because you may not know. The other definition is of a human subject, and I use the term subject, we, you know, like participant, but I'm using the terms directly from the regulations just to kind of keep that consistent. So human subject's a living individual about whom you either interact with or to collect personal identifiable information, or about whom you collect personal identifiable information. So another very, very big way people basically come out from under IRB purview or review is if they're looking at data about individuals, but they don't look at personal identifying information. That is one of the key ways that we can tell you that you don't meet the definition of human subjects research, and thus don't need any to have any interaction with the IRB office. Obviously, family and consumer studies, I think, is a good example. There's, you know, very large, very well-funded studies like using U.S. Census or other publicly available data sets, but you would never be able to necessarily drill down to private identifiable information about a living individual. So we can say, well, that's clearly systematic and clearly does involve living individuals. It doesn't meet that definition because you don't collect identifiable information. So the regs are very intentionally written that if you don't function with identifiers, you often can avoid sort of the human subjects protection piece related to the IRB, and that's a good thing. I can tell you I have, you know, 16 staff members and we oversee 6,000 studies. We're not looking to tell anyone that they need IRB review if they don't. We're more than happy to tell you if it doesn't meet the regulatory definition that we feel we have to oversee to be a compliant institution, then we'll be more than happy to tell you that. And there's a couple ways you can get it. You can basically call and just ask us, because again, if it's not human subjects research, you don't really need any formal review. Or we've created a really shortened IRB application that's called a non-human subjects determination. Again, awkward, but that's the term the regs use. And that's about basically two pages, the first being kind of your typical contact information, what department you're with, your faculty sponsors, things like that. Then you can answer a few questions related to those definitions. And if it's clear you don't meet the definition, we'll actually send you a letter that says that. And you can provide that to journals or to societies or the groups you would present, and they always accept that. I've never seen that questioned or rejected. And the beauty of that piece, unlike, again, the sort of the generalizable piece, is that if you conduct your entire project and it didn't meet the definition of human subject research, and then you seek to publish and you're asked about IRB approval, it doesn't matter that you already did it because you don't fall within the definition. We'll just give you the letter at that point. So that's actually a nice way to be able to handle these. Yeah?
Obviously, it sounds like if you're anywhere close to that, at least do the short form application to get the letter.
Yes, if you feel that, or you even want us to weigh in whether or not it's human subjects, it is, you can do that. And in fact, probably a really good way to do it to save time is call first. The staff's very accessible, and we do this all the time. You can talk to us a little bit about the project, and we can probably even tell you whether you should take the time on the two-page form or not. But did you have a follow-up? Sorry. Yes, as long as it's not human subject research, it can be issued after the fact. If it is human subject research, then it's a different can of worms. Yeah, toast. You guys, seriously, we're not as intimidating as you all. This is terrible. Like you're hanging people from trees or something. No. Okay.
I have a question that comes up a lot, and that is, if you're going to interview people in their professional position,
yeah,
you know, a political decision maker or somebody working for an agency, just talking about the work that they do professionally, is that human?
In many cases, we would say it's not. I mean, we do that quite often. You know, again, I think the key that we have to wrestle with in the definition is just justification. Even if you want to publish identifiable information, an interesting wrinkle in that is that. When something hits our door, let's say we decide it does meet those two definitions, so at least it's human subjects research that we should look at. The next step is basically exempt categories. So the regulations set forth a number of exempt categories. There's six of them that will really potentially apply most often in the main campus setting. But one of those categories actually speaks to an exemption if you are going to interview public figures as well and identify them, because it's essentially it states that that is something that, I think the term they use, though, is interesting. It's elected officials. I can send you guys the actual exemption category, but it's essentially written to say that people in a public office should expect that, you know, their opinions will be disseminated and linked to their identity. So even if it might meet the definition of research, we issue a lot of exemptions, which basically means if you meet one of these exempt categories, you get our initial approval, and unless you significantly change the project such that it would change the category, you never have to come back to us. So and that's again why this is kind of an interesting group. I think a lot of folks in this group will probably fall somewhere in the range of either non-human subjects research or maybe exempt human research, where you'd come to us once, get your exemption, and then be able to go forward. So then kind of the next tier, the regs are written based on risk levels, and knowing that all of this is quite, you know, very low risk, I think, in general, is that if you meet the definition, then we ask ourselves, do you meet one of the exempt categories? If you don't meet any of those categories, the next step is called minimal risk research, which is essentially defined as the risk that one can associate with living their everyday lives. They don't comment on what that might be and the differences of different people's everyday lives, but the best that we can really say is we try to sort of look at sort of a, you know, a magical sort of Joe average type of a situation, in the sense that the IRB doesn't say things like, well, so-and-so already lives in a socioeconomically disadvantaged neighborhood with higher crime, so if we subject them to slightly higher risk, that would be fine given their situation. Or, you know, in a biomedical example, a good one is, you know, can we subject a kid who already has cancer to more risk because this is something that they're already dealing with in their everyday life? And that's not how we do it. We try to kind of form a very, you know, kind of a baseline, if that's even possible to do. Yeah. So if you fall in the minimal risk category, often what will trigger that is that you want to collect and keep identifiers, and you may even want to publish and identify individuals other than these public figures identified in an exemption category. The big difference, what that really means for you and your research, is that if you fall in minimal risk, the study will have to be reviewed either annually or every 2 years. It's called continuing review. So minimal risk and above that requires this annual continuing review. The nice thing is that in the last 10 years or so, IRBs, I think, have become a lot more flexible in the way that the regs are interpreted, and I think that the regulators, even though they rarely issue actual guidance about this behind the regs, have shown that they're supportive. And that is that in order to be a human research protection program, we sign a document called a federal-wide assurance. So the university, for our 6,000 studies, has one FWA number that the Office of Human Research and the FDA are aware of. And under that number, basically what we say is they can ask to come and view anything that's done under our federal-wide assurance. They can audit us. They can sanction us. They can do whatever they feel might be appropriate if they think there are issues. But the way that the FWA is designed is that you can check a box that basically says we will follow all the federal regulations to the letter and apply those regulations to all research conducted at the university, versus the actual flexibility to say we'll only apply those regulations to studies that are federally funded, because the government requires that we apply all of the regulations to the letter of the law with federal funding. If, for example, you're not receiving any funding, then we have the latitude to make different decisions. So we watched a few schools. Michigan was a big one that really pushed this, and we were very impressed with how they did it. But a number of years ago, we actually put in place a model in which if you do receive minimal risk approval, we'll grant you a 2-year approval, because if you're not federally funded, it's within our purview to decide that. And we did that because we've noticed a lot of these projects actually wrap up within 2 years, so you never have to do a continuing review, because we totally acknowledge the risk is often very low and you're really just reporting back to us, and we're, you know, nodding and saying thank you, and that's basically busy work for all of us. So even today, if you rise to the level of minimal risk, it's very much like getting an exemption or even a non-human subject determination if your project is concluded within a couple of years. If it's not and you do need to do a continuing review, that's much shorter and easier than a new study application as well. I think those will probably be the most interesting sort of nuances for a group like yours. It's where you fall and whether you actually even need IRB review and approval for what you intend to do. But a big one, I would say, is if you have the hope or intent to perhaps generalize the knowledge later, or certainly publish in a peer-reviewed journal, it may just be better to either get the non-human subjects determination or go through us and get whatever determination we make, rather than kind of run the risk of doing something really interesting and then having us say, well, that was human subjects research and you should have had the approval up front.
Data that, you know, has personal information in it, but what you write about it is depersonalized?
It's an excellent question. So the way that the exemption categories are designed is there's one category that says you can collect identifiable data. It's kind of confusing. You can look in an identifiable data set, so often it's whatever that might be, but if you collect that data in your research database in a way that strips those identifiers, then you fall into an exempt category four. But again, it's kind of an interesting category. You can look at identifiers, but the ones that you record for your research data set have to not link back to the to those folks. If you do that, then it does meet the definition of human subjects research, but it's exempt under category four. Yep. Good question. So, you know, the way that the IRB here works, we're fully automated. We use a system called ERICA, which is the Electronic Research Integrity and Compliance Administration System, kind of unwieldy. I wanted to call it HAL, but they didn't like my sense of humor. And ERICA has basically been designed. I've been in the IRB for about 12 years and the director for 11 or so. And the way that the system was designed even from back in when I first started is to be a one-stop shop for researchers, for faculty and students. So all of the committees, including the IRB, that would might be associated with your project are rolled into ERICA. And when you start an application within the system, it's routed based on the information you tell us. Our other fond way to refer to ERICA is the electronic choose your own adventure. But we mean that because it uses a smart form technology. So based on the first page, when you tell us who you are, whether you're student or faculty, what department you're working in, who your sponsor is, that page alone, just from the department you are in, like a main campus department, for example, versus a biomed department where the FDA and HIPAA and all these other things can come into play, huge portions of the application just disappear based on those initial answers. So it's designed to save you time and really only ask you the questions we need to ask you in order to get your project approved. But to give you some sense of that, everyone today under current regs has to file a conflict of interest disclosure, even though I think something like 99.something% of faculty and staff don't have any conflict. And almost the only time you do see that's actually MDs who consult with pharma companies and things like that. So by triggering, by going into ERIC and triggering that, you can say you have no conflict and immediately you'll get a response back that you've passed through the COI process and whatever other committees might be associated with it to get you right through to the IRB review. So the nice piece is, again, as main campus researchers, by even selecting the department you're in main campus, you've probably cut two-thirds of the ERICA pages right out of the mix, and you'll just be left with the questions that we would ask you, probably more related to the research in your domain. And that's the way we want to do it as well, because we tend to triage the projects based on risk level. So if you happen to have a non-human subjects request for us to review, we often turn that around in 2 to 3 days. It's very quick. We can look at your form and pretty quickly decide whether we agree that the definitions do or don't apply. An exemption is usually about 2 weeks, which is, I'm proud to say, extremely fast for an academic medical IRB and even competitive with some of the big commercial IRBs out there these days. So the main issue that would happen to you as you kind of go up the risk level is actually the length of review. It takes longer to get an expedited review, which is a minimal risk study, because that one can't just be done at the staff level. It goes to one of our faculty reviewers. It doesn't have to be discussed by a convened board, but that one reviewer has to review it and turn it around. And you know, as many of you know, the faculty people who serve on our board just do that as part of their mission at the U. They serve as part of their mission. So these are busy folks who have more than full-time jobs, and we try to give them about a week to 10 days to complete a project. My staff that has to do this all day can turn around these other requests pretty quickly because that's, you know, what we do. But we try to give our board members usually about a week to 10 days to actually review the projects. So the main thing you're really looking at in the difference of risk level is just the time it takes to get your initial approval and whether or not you need to do a continuing review. Yeah.
On to a completed IRB, so that then, like in the case of Anna Bergevin, Albert Park in Primary Children's had the IRB for the larger CMB study. He added me on, then he added Anna on, and so it was just an administrative change in personnel, and you don't have to then deal with all the review process. So that's just one small thing to keep in mind. Not all projects have to be projects where, if you're going to be dealing with human subjects, that you have to be the one who's done the IRB work.
That's a great comment, yeah. And I can tell you, too, the way that our system's evolved over the years, we triage amendments, too, based on complexity. So if we receive an amendment, for example, from Dr. Park or Dr. Zick that just says we're adding two new study team members to contribute, that's done very, very quickly as compared to some, you know, large change to the research design or something like that. We do see more and more of that. Also, we do see a lot, if you don't choose to be the lead investigator for your own project, then some of what we've seen is some faculty sponsors have switched to make themselves the principal investigator, and they just list the student who's doing the project as a co-investigator. So the faculty sponsor kind of cue is then eliminated. It's just that if you communicate closely and know what's being submitted, then the faculty member can submit it, you know, quickly, and you won't go into that other kind of holding queue for your study. The only other definition of research actually above minimal risk is greater than minimal risk, which, as you can imagine from the minimal risk definition, just means that you have a higher magnitude of probability of harm than you would expect in your everyday life. But I can tell you there's very few greater than minimal risk projects on main campus. Usually it's projects in which you might be studying illegal behaviors or activities or something that could place the participants at what the IRB might consider significantly greater risk than they might normally experience if they hadn't participated in the research. But for the most part, when we say greater than minimal risk, we're talking about a clinical study that usually involves an experimental drug or device. So you rarely will fall into that category. A lot more requirements are put in place if you do fall into that category. But Dr. Zick would be a good example. She's had to deal with crossing the line into HIPAA and in working with a pediatrician and, you know, cytomegalovirus. That's one that would make you have to deal with the HIPAA regulations related to privacy of people's health information and stuff like that. It's not in any way going to stop you from doing what you want to do, but there are certainly more hoops to jump through if you happen to want to do your research in a biomedical setting with people's health information. That definitely adds a level of complexity that on the IRB side. And probably on your side, the biggest thing you'd see is consent forms get longer. There's more required language to talk about how you would share people's information. But another piece I wanted to talk about just briefly in a group like this too is to let you know is that, you know, the traditional model of consent, which might be some sort of a basic cover letter or even a consent document, you know, number of pages long, is great and still works and is applied a lot today. But the IRB has a ton of latitude in how we can address consent. So we can waive the need for consent altogether based on the study, and if it can be argued that consent would be prohibitive for this study. For example, I do believe we've seen a few studies related to undocumented workers in which we just simply waived the consent requirement because we understand that no one was going to sign a traditional form or want to do it in that manner. Another tool we kind of have in our toolbox that I think, again, has been used a lot more in the last 4 or 5 years is we can approve an alteration of consent. So in other words, you could say, well, I can get consent. I want to discuss my study. I might even give someone a one-page letter about it, but they don't have to sign it, and I don't want them to sign it, and I don't want to keep a record of that. So there's almost any variety of ways that you can do it. And based on the way you think is best for your research, we would ask that you propose it that way. One of the things we see from a lot of students is I think they assume we're going to be a lot more sort of rigid or whatever the word would be, draconian, than we really are. I mean, we're happy as long as the process is justified given the design to grant all these various alterations in how we might want to do a study. So sometimes we'll see a consent document that just seems kind of crazy, and we'd say, you know, this doesn't look like it's going to work, and the student will say, well, my faculty sponsor just said you're going to want a consent form, so I wrote one, but I don't really want to use one. And you know, we've got one, for example, that's examining, I think, opinions related to professional soccer in Utah, and this person wants to go and have discussions with people who are kind of hardcore soccer fans in a few known venues where they, you know, where they hang out. And we got this consent form that was just crazy that I can, you know, think if you're going to having a beer or something in a pub and someone walks up with this thing and then wants to talk to you about soccer. And we just called the person and said, you know, why did you do it this way? Wouldn't you rather just, you know, waive consent or maybe just have a verbal process where you say, hey, I'm interested in this and I'd like to talk to you about it. And he said, well, yeah, I thought you'd make me do a big form. And, you know, it's like, that's not the way it works. If you even want to call us and talk about your specific project or any challenges, we'll be happy to discuss it with you and make sure we can do it in the way that kind of best accommodates what you'd like to do. But that can all be done online. It's all done through the ERICA system. Essentially, the system's up 24/7 except for, you know, some weekends in the middle of the night on Saturday when we do our updates. But for the most part, it's essentially available to you if you've got a web connection, and you can go in and use it anytime to submit your work. My staff's, you know, an 8-to-5 group, so if you submit something at midnight, you know, it'll hit our queue in the morning. But nonetheless, it's there and available for you if you'd like to use it. We're a very automated institution, even for big institutions our size. We've devoted a lot of resources and time to it over the years, and it's a pretty impressive, sophisticated system at this point. We get to go around the country and talk to IRB nerds about how our system works. But yeah, I didn't really come with kind of a canned longer presentation or anything like that. I wanted to make sure that I could answer any questions and not take too much of your time. you guys do have any more questions or anything specific, or if there's anything you guys kind of thought I needed to cover that I, you know, I'm not covering, I'm happy to do that as well. But do please tell everyone we're very, very scary when you know what I do.
I think you've done a very good job in making the IRB process a lot less frightening and seeming a lot more streamlined.
Thanks very much.
Well, I would just add as a personal testimony here, I mean, I've called you on numerous occasions saying, I don't know what to do, I got to this point in the application, and I've also called your staff, and sometimes I've been frustrated. They've always been incredibly patient and understanding. It's, I mean, I've just been very impressed with the help that I've received from the IRB over the years. So when in doubt, call them. They are very helpful.
Well, thanks a lot. I can tell you we're going through, so we've been accredited for kind of the gold standard of human research accreditation programs since 2007. We love unwieldy acronyms in the IRB, but it's a group called AHARP with a double A and a double P, but it's the Association for the Accreditation of Human Research Protection Programs. When we initially accredited, we got 3 years, and then it's such a rigorous process that I think they listened to all the institutions and they moved the accreditation up to 5 years. So we're going through our third round, hopefully to get 5 more years here in a couple weeks in March, and I'm really proud to say that they can acknowledge sort of fields of excellence, and in our last one was the collaborative nature of our IRB. So to give you some sense of that, at a lot of IRBs, it blows my mind to tell you the truth, their members, for example, are prohibited from talking to primary investigators or investigators and faculty because they feel that that's not appropriate or they could be pressure exerted or whatever it is. We have built a model where we say, essentially, if you don't feel you can approve a study, and one way that plays out on our board is it's being tabled, which means it has to kind of be looked at all over again and can add a month to your review. We say if you're looking to if you think you might have to table a study or have strong concerns, contact the investigator, have a conversation with them, and try to work through your issues. And I can tell you today we table a remarkably low percentage of projects, and our entire kind of ethos in our office is to be very transparent and very collaborative. And we hope, and it's very nice to hear that. I mean, that's what we try to do. Definitely at the staff level, that's something we really preach as well.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
For taking the time
Thank you. Well, thanks very much.